Mark Twain famously said, "I've had a lot of worries in my life, most of which never happened." That's true. We can all attest to that. There was a company that was founded in 1971 by three fellows. They produced T-shirts and other apparel aimed at extreme sports called No Fear. Well, No Fear was the brand. And it was a popular slogan back in the 90s. But in 2011, they filed Chapter 11 bankruptcy. Still around, employing 400 or so people. I don't see their products much anymore. Maybe they fell into some trouble because, well, maybe we conquered all of our fear. Hardly. In 1901, Mark Twain wrote an essay, and in that essay, he penned this sentence: "Each man is afraid of his neighbor's disapproval, a thing which, to the general run of the human race, is more dreaded than wolves and death." He's right. He's right. Here we are bearing down on the summer of 2018. Today is the last day of May, May the 31st, 2018. By the way, Twain penned that sentence. He wrote that essay in the summer of 1901, just a mere 117 years ago. It's funny. Some things just don't change. There are some fears that are more universal than others, and we are all afraid of something, more than we may want to admit. But today, I'm not here to coach you up about having no fear. Instead, I'm here to tell you that I'm rather fond of fear. I'm a fan of fear because it can be a terrific catalyst for taking action. Now, it can paralyze us. I'm a fan of the former, not the latter. I'm a fan of it driving us to get on with something, to do something. As business owners, business people, well, we are people after all, and people have fears. In the last number of years, our economy has rebounded quite nicely from the Great Recession of 2008. Many people have enjoyed pretty solid prosperity over the last number of years. But good times or bad times, it doesn't matter. You're going to find businesses that are succeeding pretty wildly, and you're going to find some other businesses that are struggling. Recent companies in the news would include Toys R Us, Gibson, the guitar manufacturer, Remington, the gun folks, Winn-Dixie. There are a lot of others who have endured some defeat during this time of prosperity. Plenty to be afraid of. And as I sit down and I talk with small business owners, these are people operating companies that run anywhere from $5 million in annual revenue to in excess of $200 million. Prosperity just isn't always a remedy for fear, because many of the prosperous business owners are fearful, when's it going to end? When's it going to end? There's a lot of conversation about the economic forecast and what's coming and how should we hunker down and get ready. So success fosters its own kind of fear. Fear that we may not be able to sustain the current rate of success that we enjoy. Worry that our growth is going to stall. I don't think that small business owners as a breed, I don't think that we are necessarily a neurotic bunch. But to some, I guess it can look like it. But I'm a fan of fear. I'm a fan of leveraging it as the resource that it is, and that really is what today's video is all about, helping us leverage our fear so that we take some action. Sitting down with a CEO and an accounting clerk had divulged something to her boss, and there was some mysterious code accounting thing, and upon deeper inspection, it turns out that there was a little bit of skimming going on. A lot of hours and a lot of research and heightened paranoia, to be sure. And turns out that, yeah, there was substantial. The conversation that we all had was, until you really know, you're paranoid that you're just seeing tip of the iceberg. Maybe you've been there and you've experienced this. It's what you don't know that you're more afraid of than what you do know. Well, over the course of weeks, as this investigation went on, very clandestine, it was revealed that it amounted to a few thousand dollars. It wasn't money that was going to make or break the company, but it was disturbing. It was disturbing. A prospering company, and here's somebody, and so it begged the question by the owner and top leadership, how can this happen? How can this happen? That fear could have produced just a heightened sense of extreme paranoia. We're not going to trust anybody. We're going to batten down the hatches. We're going to lock and load. But instead, to their credit, leadership team under the leadership of the owner chose rather to embrace their fear and approach it more from the notion of we have got to do a better job of keeping honest people honest. And yes, the employee was terminated with cause and with proof. But the approach, I thought, was rather unique in that we're not going to let this be our culture. Our culture isn't going to be a culture of paranoia and fear and anxiety. We need to put some safeguards in place. And over the course of that discussion, and coming from retail where internal theft is just a way of life, part of our discussion was the fact that the people that really want to get you, they're going to get you. You can put safeguards in place, but the professional thief is going to achieve some degree of success in likelihood before they are found. You know, the trick is to be proactive and stay on top of it. But how can you do that without letting fear just rule the day? In another situation, a key employee in the leadership team comes to the owner one day and announces, I'm leaving. And here's my 2-week notice, whatever it was. Might have been 30 days, but whatever. Completely blindsided the owner. Things were going well. Things were going good. He didn't see it coming at all. And now you can embrace a fear of, well, who else am I going to lose? Instead, the owner chose a different course of action. The owner was very happy for this employee. This employee was going to go and do something slightly different, an opportunity that this employee just felt was, frankly, just too good to pass up. It wasn't necessarily anything to do with some monumental amount of money or any other perks. It was a different challenge. And this person was at a point in their life they felt like they wanted that different challenge. Well, the owner could choose to be angry, be driven by fear that somebody else is going to leave too, and now what am I going to do? And instead, this owner was able to step outside of himself, yes, with a little bit of coaching, a little bit of assistance to think this through, and to leverage the fear, what could have been fear and anxiety, into something that, quite frankly, was not only profitable to him as an owner, but profitable to the person leaving, and was profitable to everybody else who was still in the leadership team once this person exited the company. It helped maintain and even build, I would argue, build and increase a culture that was just more conducive to this is a great place to work. This is a supportive place to work. All of this to say one thing. Your reaction and your response to fear is the critical thing. You can sit back and you can lament and you can pine and we can castigate regulations and government and the market and competition and people and our employees and customers and all the rest of it. Or we can decide that, yeah, it certainly is fearful. It's fearful for every small business owner who has a leadership team that somebody at any given point could be preparing their resignation letter. The proactive small business owners are able to have contingency plans, even if they're loose, even if they're just kind of up here, to pre-think scenarios and situations that might happen so that we can prepare better for what's our response going to be. Just this week, Texas Governor Abbott was dealing with this school shooting phenomenon that is happening and trying to deploy some things that could at least move the ball forward to our ability to manage, if not prevent, these incidents from happening. And part of it was not only scenario training, but instead of just being paralyzed that at any moment a kid can walk into a school and unleash this rage with an automatic weapon or some kind of a gun and harm, if not kill, a number of people in mere seconds or minutes, to instead channel that fear to, okay, well, what can we do? What training can we provide? What systems can we deploy? Up to and including something that you might think, well, that doesn't seem like such a big deal. An alarm warning that is different than the alarm warnings that students typically hear. You know, we all grew up and we endured fire drills. If you're in this part of the country, I'm in Dallas-Fort Worth, Texas, and it's tornado country. So we had tornado drills, we had fire drills, and that bell, that sound, it was all the same when I was a kid. And so to channel that fear into being innovative and thinking we need a separate signal, some signal that lets everybody know we have got an active shooter situation, and now everyone by training and by preparation, now we know what's happening and we know what we need to do. Well, it's either that or we just do nothing and we just continue to live in fear. And then when it happens, we don't know what to do. It's no different in our businesses than it is in our schools or any other situation. Fear can rule the day, or we can leverage fear as the resource that it is to help us, to motivate us, to inspire us to be innovative and to think about what we're doing and to think about why we're doing it and to think about, is this effective? Is this the most effective thing that we can do? So I'm not here today to promote the moniker no fear. I'm here to promote that you need to embrace your fear. You need to face your fear. And you need to deal with it as effectively as you can. It doesn't matter if you're looking at line items of a P&L and you're trying to figure out ways to cut money from a budget or ways to find money to fund something else in a budget. It doesn't matter if it's dealing with people. It doesn't matter what it's dealing with. Every aspect of our business, we realize that there's something to be afraid of, and we can be better prepared in dealing with, if it is an eventuality, then let's go ahead and face it and let's say, okay, let's go ahead and play these what if games that as business people we're so fond of playing. We just like to play the what if games usually on a more positive side, but I'm encouraging you that this is a positive thing. This is a very positive thing for us to pre-plan, pre-think these scenarios. My name is Randy Cantrell. You can visit the website at growgreat.com. Are you a small business owner? 5 million to 50 million probably is a sweet spot of annual revenue, but don't let the size, don't let the smallness or the largeness fool you. Visit thepeeradvantage.com. The Peer Advantage by Bula Network is a new endeavor. I'm forming two peer advisory groups of small business owners where we can come together and we can help one another. And these are virtual, these are online, very convenient. All the details and all the fine print, which there isn't any, can be found at thepeeradvantage.com. May's over, and now we're staring down the barrel of June, so time's clipping on. So all the best to you and your small business.